after a big day yesterday, a big day yesterday, I was singing that song, His Strength is Perfect When Our Strength is Small. And then I asked Dorinda to, you know, open the email and get the song ready. And she starts playing that very song that I was singing before I put two and two together that that was the song. And it was a tremendous blessing into the timing yesterday. But we made it to the finish line. We're going to look at this verse and others surrounding it in Acts chapter 20, verse 17. This is the message that was prepared for last week. If you were not here last week, there is a presentation of it on Facebook, okay, last week's message. And so you could get it there. If you need trouble with that because you have a low maintenance face, I could text you a link. I have a low maintenance face. Don't all say amen, okay? But if you would like that, we could text you that link. If you don't know what I'm talking about with that, then we will send up a smoke signal, okay, to help you. We're studying the journeys then of the Apostle Paul and the reunions there as he from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and he called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, ye know, from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, and how that I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now behold, I know that ye all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Let's pray that God would be honored as these words are unfolded in these moments. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for all the counsel of God. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the record of this history lesson in the book of Acts and for this tearful reunion and impartation of heart from the apostle to the assembly and to the leaders there on the island of Miletus. And Father, I pray that you would help us to echo out, Lord, the love and the mission in this our day to this assembly and to this entire region, Lord, and to our lost and needy world, that you would help us, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. With many tears, he comes. And I wonder just what you have ever cried over or have cried over already today. This is not the testimony time. And it's not the personality quiz of how are you wired. For some would cry at the drop. I was going to say the drop of a hat. I'm going to say the drop of a cat. I love cat lovers to tease them. now and then. But what do you cry over? What makes you cry? Maybe you've cried over spilled milk. Maybe there's a crocodile or a manipulative tear that would be shed at a will, at a whim, but not of a tug of the heart. What do you cry about? What do you talk about? What you cry about or talk about, what will it mean in 100 years? What will it mean in 100 years? Tears shed. What will it mean in 1,000 years? It's an interesting question. We cry over things that don't mean anything, like I forgot what it was. And I wonder if we talk about, cry about, if things are important to us that will be important forever. Remember the words of my father, there are only two things that are eternal. And I'm sure it wasn't original with him, but the word of God and the souls of men. Is there any tear stains on your Bible? We're going to find that Paul's Bible, the original, like when he penned it, was written with many tears. Are there any tears on your Bible? Are there tears over lost souls, tears over situations, tears over people's growth and maturity in Christ? What would bring you to tears? Will you shed one? Is the question. If we could describe the Apostle Paul in one word through this passage ringing out, in my mind, that one word would be this word before you today of servant. Serving the Lord with all humility of mind. I wonder if that would be a good word as an epitaph for your life. What are you? Who are you? What is your identity? Is it an occupation? Is it a position? Is it something with great esteem? Or would it be this humble word, servant, even a slave of the Lord Jesus Christ? That would describe your life and your day today. Your heart, your mentality, and your activity. A desire to serve the Lord Jesus Christ, and in serving him, serve others. This was the heart of the Apostle Paul that I would like to see echoed and accented by his tears. So let's look at the passage a little bit and see this servant as he cries. We find them, and we find him to be a sincere servant. You can hear the heartbeat. You know what manner of man I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears. Trials, temptations which befell me by the lying weight of the Jews. He's pouring out his heart to these church leaders whom he spent much time with. You spend some time with somebody, you get to know their heart. Amen? You get to know how they think and how they feel. You get to know how they tick. And we can spend time with the Apostle Paul in this passage, and we get to see that others saw. He invited others into his life, and he said they know what manner of man he was. It wasn't just what he said. Sometimes you wonder, with the World Wide Web and podcasts and TV broadcasts, and you wonder just how they're produced, and sometimes there is no panning of the audience. There is no audience, but it seems like there is one. Maybe dubbed in, I don't know. And then the crocodile tears to be turned on and turned off. We're not talking about those kind of tears. He served the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears. And I'm saying he was a sincere servant of Jesus Christ. His life matched his lip. this is what happened, where the real test of sincerity is not just in what you say and what comes out of your mouth, for there's a lot of big talkers, but how about big walkers? And is there a Bible in shoe leather that is lived out for the glory of God? It's life and lip. What a wonderful day we shared yesterday. Amen? It was exciting. I can't believe that I got this moment on video. Okay? This was a moment. Okay? There was a family coming up, and rushing up was the father and the little boy. And we might need a little oompa on the, on the volume, Kenny, if you could turn that up ahead of time. I think it's very important that you hear what the little boy says. Okay, that should be good, but we'll try to listen in. Yes, turn it up, leave it up. Okay, you can almost hear Blaze talking. What he's saying, I give him the gospel. Everything is free. And I'm thinking that we had a good time. Yes, giving away. Yes, in the flurry of it. But in the sharing of the gospel. The sharing of the gospel. This is what it was all about. And to give out the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ one-on-one. And not to pick on Blaze, but he brought his lawnmower and actually succeeded in getting rid of his lawnmower. A fond memory. That's not the one we mow with on a daily basis. And that is not the chainsaw that we saw with, okay? But, you know, he looked good in the picture there. And if you could just try to notice the serious on his face. I said, Blaze, he says, I'm going out door to door. Well, that's in the passage here, publicly, from house to house. I said, Blaze, please stay. They're coming to us today. And then I turn around and I got this montage. And Blaze, it is beautiful, amen? He was witnessing a mic. I mean, like, it was like, I don't know what they're talking about. But it was amazing. And what an opportunity we had right on to the wonderful and joyful and blessing. This is just the Blaze montage here of the shots that I received of the opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to give out the gospel. Some were maybe not as excited. But then it seemed like the excitement came in, amen? Okay, and it wasn't too long, and Blaze was saying, someone got saved.
That's him on the left.
What's that?
That's him on the left.
Yes, the man that got saved. And so from the lawnmower and the chainsaw, not too exciting, to the smile, there's nothing like serving the Lord. Amen. Nothing like serving the Lord. Nothing like touching a life for the glory of God.
Gary, can I have that?
Yes. Not right this moment. Not right now. Okay. But it is by our life, amen, that backs up our lip for the glory of God, that would help us to be challenged in this sincerity of life. That a lost world needs. Someone said they don't care what you know until they know you care. And this touching people's lives is not some, like, a notch on a gun, okay? A notch on a gospel gun. It is eternally precious. And what a joy to touch people's lives for eternity. Are you involved in that? This is the message publicly. This is the message privately, publicly, and from house to house, at all manners of times and seasons. They knew what he was like because they were with him and he was with them. When you're with somebody, like really with them, like with them and then with them, It doesn't take long where you see some rough edges. Amen. Don't say amen too loud, ladies. Okay? And you at all seasons. But I pray that a heart that is sincere before the Lord can be seen. We're talking about tears, not put on. God given. Amen. That would be a good description for with many tears. God given. I would say you are what you are, what you really are, when you are what? When you're all alone. When you're all alone. Publicly, privately, in the synagogues and in the marketplaces where life is on display. And then privately and from house to house as he broke bread and as he blessed those people and churches were started in houses for the glory of God, this servant could be described as sincere. And that's a challenge, amen, to us all with many tears. Great heaviness and sorrow, Romans 9 and verse 1 says that he had in his heart for the Jewish people. We'll find them persecuting him in response, but he had great heaviness and he could wish himself accursed for Christ for their sake. What words from a sincere servant's heart. He was burdened for the people. He says, out of anguish of heart in 2 Corinthians 2 and verse 4, if you're jotting some notes, 2 Corinthians 2 and verse 4, for out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears. There's the tear-stained Bible of its original autograph. It was burdened for the false teachers, and we'll get into that next time we visit this, and the departing and grievous wolves may even end this meeting breaking down in tears. Why? Because of a sincere love for the brethren. Wow. Think of the Apostle Paul's life from what you know of it and listen to the list that he recounts and ask if he ever cried while I read this. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. 5 times. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I spent in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the heathen, in perils of the city, in perils of the wilderness, in perils of the sea, in perils of false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, and besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Think there were any tears? Wow. Many tears. Many tears. Much upon his shoulders. But he testified publicly and privately. What did he testify? Repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. It's kind of an outdated message now, isn't it? You don't hear that. You don't hear that word much anymore. Repent. You heard it from John the Baptist. He thundered out of the wilderness. Repent. He even put a little teeth to it and said, bring forth fruit of repentance. Not just words, not just crocodile, not just I'm sorry I got caught, but life changed from the heart and mind changed. Repentance towards sin, faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the message. This is the message that needs to be preached. This is the message that was preached as the Apostle Paul recounts it, that he preached to the Gentiles and to the Jews that men should repent and turn to God. This is what was preached in the gospel. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is what is to be preached. In the Great Commission, that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Have you ever humbly, have you ever sincerely called someone to repent? That's the need. Because the bottom line of people, why they won't get saved, And you can spin it for intellectual reasons. You can spin it. They think they're agnostic. They think there is no God, and atheism. And they can come up with all kinds of thoughts and ideas. But the bottom line is men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil.
Amen.
And they won't come to the light lest their deeds be reproved. That's in the verse of our favorite, John 3:16. For God so loved the world. Read the next, and the next, and the next. Yeah. And find out the real reason why people won't bow before the Lord Jesus Christ. I said to someone last night, I'll see you in church tomorrow. Not me! I don't believe it. Gave me some cult and some ism and some occult thing to look up on the internet. I did not. And I said to him, you will bow one day to the Lord Jesus Christ. No, I won't. Yes, you will. And so, lovingly, we call people to repentance. But we need to be sincere in how we do it. Many tears. He was also a suffering servant, and this is where we see him, talking about the lion in wait of the Jews, and then verse 22, and now, behold, I go bound in the spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that befall me there, save the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city that bonds and afflictions abide me there. This is kind of the test, isn't it? It gets a little deeper, doesn't it? It gets a little more, are you ready for this? Like, if the next step is going to lead to suffering, how many are in? How many are up for it? I can talk about this now. I think, Lynn, that we were shut down financially, and we still don't know why.
Right.
Okay? We want to blame it on the Spanish because it was Homeland Security, but we're not sure. We don't know. All we know is that checks were bouncing and the accounts were frozen. And it was over some glitch, and we could probably blame it on the bank as we set some things up and maybe something was missing. And then Lynn was on vacation. We can blame him. And Homeland Security was trying to get a hold of us and the banker. And then when he got back, I think the banker was on vacation. And Homeland Security said, I'll get your attention. And it completely froze. And it was some glitch, and the glitch was taken care of with the retrieval of the documents that we had already given them and all this. And it's worked out. But it made me wonder with the muscle I saw. It made me wonder with the power and no communication, under a very friendly administration, I would say, what if the tide was turned? What if a message live streamed or put up was deemed hate? And it was, how many are in? How many are on? What if we couldn't meet publicly, but we had to meet house to house, and even that, to cover our tracks? What if, like in China, a wave of freedom, then a wave of crushing now control back? In Russia too, look out. And today, more persecution than in any day of the Christian church's history is going on right underneath. And I wonder if it wouldn't be good for us. I wonder if it wouldn't be a blessing. You hear the stories of under communism where the soldiers came in with machine guns and says, anybody who's not willing to die for their faith, just run out right now. And a bunch of people ran out. And they put down their guns and said, now we're ready to pray and worship God with our brothers and sisters, our true brothers and sisters in the Lord. And what if it came? What if it came? Are you willing to live for Christ? Don't answer that question. You say, well, I'd be willing to die for Christ, okay? Well, don't answer that question. In fact, answer the one question by the other question. If you'd say, well, I'd be willing to die for Christ, how do you know if you're not willing to live for Christ today? We're not willing to have someone slam a door in our face. We're not willing to have someone say, oh, you're one of them, huh? And take a stand at work or in the neighborhood or put it on the line for the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what the Apostle Paul did. This is what needs to be done in our lives, that we might be willing to suffer. Maybe the loss of a little reputation. Maybe the loss of a little finance. Maybe the loss of a job or a contract or something. Because we're going to vibrantly live for the Lord Jesus Christ in our personal and our private and our public lives for the glory of God. This is what the Apostle Paul did. And who's upset and who's persecuting him? The hypocrites, okay? The hypocrites. The people who should know better but didn't do better. The people who had the oracles of God and were to be the light to lighten the Gentiles, but no, through muddiness and dimness and outness, they rejected the Savior. And now they were rejecting the people who followed the Savior. And it was very, very sad. And he was going to go to bonds and afflictions. But the answer for this suffering servant was that he was already bound, wasn't he? He went bound in the Spirit. Bound in the Spirit. An interesting phrase. I'm going to just throw out this phrase to help us. What does it mean, bound in the Spirit? How about a deep-seated sense of duty? A deep-seated sense of, woe be unto me if I preach not the gospel. Bound in the Spirit. That's a good binding. Amen. That binding will not lead to the freedom into sin and living any way you like. It would be to live any way you ought for the glory of God. Bound in the Spirit of God. Bound in the Spirit of God would get you up in the middle of the night and you'd be praying. Bound in the Spirit of God would help you meet the day and say, Lord, I want you to lead my life today. And Lord, I want to live my life for you today. Bound in the Spirit might mean we bite our tongue when anger and it comes just to the brink of getting out. And no. Bound in the Spirit might cause you to hang up and say, you know, I don't need to listen to this. It might, bound in the Spirit might lead your hands to serve and help and bless others and your feet to become beautiful with the giving out of the gospel. Bound in the Spirit of God might take you right into the path of persecution, even though you know it's ahead. Paul did. We'll read later about a prophet named Agabus that tied a, you know, linen clothing around him and of Paul's garments and said, so is the one who wears this garment will be bound. And Paul said, I don't care. You could read it in Acts 21. And he said that the Holy Ghost saith that the Jews shall bind the man that owneth this and shall be delivered into the hands of the Gentiles. And when he heard these things, both we and them in that place besought him not to go into Jerusalem. Verse 13 of chapter 21, then Paul answered, what mean ye to weep and to break mine heart? For I am ready not to be bound only, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he would not be persuaded, we ceased saying, the will of the Lord be done. What's God want? Well, he's a servant. He's a servant. He's a suffering servant because he got arrested. Who did he get arrested by? He was arrested by the Holy Spirit. That's who arrested his life. That's who needs to arrest our thoughts. That's who needs to arrest, are you ready for this? Our emotions. That's who needs to arrest our private time, our me time, my time, I time. That's who needs to arrest us when we are ready to lay on that horn for the one who needs it. Now, there are probably a couple different types of beeps. I would like a horn with soft, medium, and loud. I don't like horns that you can't go boop, boop, because they only have bah. Sometimes I say to my wife, I'm doing this for their good, so that they would know that they did something wrong, because they were obviously clueless. It wasn't out of anger, it was out of information. I may have waked them up. It's possible. But what's going on in your heart? Are you arrested by the Holy Spirit of God? Is there deep-seated sense of duty to live for the Lord Jesus Christ that grips your soul and controls your life? Don't give that control away. Not an ounce of it. Not a freckle of it. To anger, to circumstances, to people, to situations, to alcohol, to addictions, to things that would come in to diminish the control of the Spirit of God in your life. I go bound in the Spirit. What would it be like to have a church? What would it be like to have a home like that? What would it be like to have a mirror like that and be able to just say, Lord, these hands are yours, these eyes are yours, this mind is yours, Lord. These feet are yours, Lord. For your glory, I'm bound in the Spirit of God. Wow. Willing to suffer. Willing, thirdly, and simply, just to be selfless. Kind of servant. A selfless servant. Let's be blessed by this beautiful verse as we close. A selfless servant. That my life is not my own, verse 24. But none of these things move me. Neither count I my life dear unto myself. I think we found the problem. No, I think we found the answer. My life dear unto myself. Is your life dear to yourself? I think our lives are dear unto ourselves. Too dear. Too dear. And it's my life and my time and my car and my house and my ability and my resources. And we didn't give them over to God. We didn't give them over to God. Hey, you think your car will make it to go on this mission for the glory of God? And the person responds, I don't know, it's not my car. It's God's, and it will go as many miles as God wants it to go. He might lead you to add a little gas and oil, too. I know one person who had a spider. I don't know what kind of car. Anybody remember a spider? You remember a spider. Did you have a spider?
Yes.
You did. Do you know that spider, without any attention of oil changes, would have gone 98,000 miles on one oil change?
I don't remember that.
No, but I know a guy who did. He added oil, but he never changed it. And then one day the engine just said, nah! Is your car God's car? Is your time God's time? Is your house God's house? Are your things God's things? Is your education God's education? Is your brain, is your ability, your talent, your time, your talent, your treasure, is it God's? Does it belong to God? You don't have anything without God. If God pulls a plug, it's pretty dark. On what you have and what you think you have. It's all God's. And he loans it unto us for us to surrender it unto him and to bless other people. And he was a selfless servant. He didn't count his life dear unto himself. Why? Because he had a course to finish. His course was not yet done. Your course is not yet done. How do I know? Take a breath. It's not done. It's not done. Your course is not done. How do I know? Rub two brain cells together. If you can do that, your course is not done. Yes, that hurts. I saw a bumper sticker this week. Think it's not illegal yet.
Go get in there.
I said Wednesday night, what is the one single thing that can prove and show our utter dependence upon God? Prayer. Then conversely, what is the one single thing in the lack of it that shows our, Christians, you and me, our independence from God? Lack of prayer. Lack of prayer. We should get really good at praying. Why? Because we can do it when we can't do anything else. We can do it when our get up and go, got up and went. This is the value to life, to the very end of life when that appointed day comes and God takes our life. It's appointed on man. It's not for us. In our culture of death. Why? Because God grants value to life from the very beginning of life. And I don't have a picture for you, it's for me. Of an invitation from one of the five daughters, not named. That invited me for the first time in 14, going on 15, to the first ultrasound. Wow. What a miracle. Are you sure there's only one? There's only one. From the very beginning of that gift of a creation miracle of God. To the very end, where someone would say, what good is it? They're just existing barely. What? What do you mean? Well, they can't move any. They're invalid now. They're on their bed. They're just waiting to die. What? Can you rub two brain cells together? You can do the most powerful thing on the planet when you can't do anything else. You can pray. We better get good at prayer because we can do it when we can't do anything else. And this servant wasn't done yet. Oh, do you ever see someone like that? They're not done yet. They're not done yet. And they get the prayer lists and you can share with them in that hospital, in that nursing home, pray for me. Well, I feel kind of selfish when I do, but I do it. I say, you got something I don't got. Time. You've got lots of time. Pray. Do the most powerful thing on the planet. Show that utter dependence upon God as a humble, sincere, suffering, selfless servant. That would live their life for others. Why? Because their race isn't yet finished. How about you? How about your race? It ain't over yet. Soldier, keep walking. Get moving. Lift your head. It ain't over yet. It's not finished yet. Let's keep going for Jesus. Could we be blessed by this song and this word today, just laid in our lap, servant. Servant. Be blessed by this and these words. Thank you.